record. Okay. So yeah, let's go through some tools. I've got the frame open here for OreSat because I think this is one of the more complicated parts that we have. And so we'll just walk through like how some of these different things work. And so I guess you can see over here, this is the feature tree for it. And so you can see there's a lot going on. We've got folders and configurations. So a lot of crazy stuff. And so feel free to, because this isn't going to be like a guided sort of thing, feel free to ask for us to just like show you what things do and what things are. I've also been off this past week, so my brain is not in SolidWorks mode, so it'll be fun. So the first thing I have on my list is the measure tool. And so this one comes in handy all the time. I think a lot of people, when they're first starting with SolidWorks, when they want to know what a dimension is, they usually go back to like that sketch and pull it from there. But the measure tool is handy because it can give you a bunch of different things. So it can give you like the area and the perimeter, and I have it set up. So if you go to your measure tool and you click on this inches and millimeters, you can change it to custom settings using dual units. So I have that so that I can see it in millimeters and inches, and that is not its default. Default will be whatever your part is, but I like to have that up just because people sometimes in the past have been like, well, what is that in inches? And instead of having to like think about it, you've got it right there. And you can change your decimal places, you can use scientific notation if you feel the need to. And so all of that is set up by me. So that is how I prefer to do it. And then the way that you use it is you can click on something first. So you can do, if you're just in the part, you can click on this face and then do the measure tool. And so it'll give you whatever thing you have selected. Or if you've already got it open, you would right click and clear or delete a specific thing. So you've got this blank blue box, and then you can come over and the little mouse looks like the little measuring tape. And then you can select multiple things. So usually what we use it for is for distance. So say I want the distance between this face and this face. So then it's going to give you all your three axes as well as the normal distance. So if you were to instead select like a specific point, which you can do too, and then maybe go like point to point, then it would show you, I'll just show you what it does. So point to, that's not what I wanted. So see, you can delete specific things. So delete the vertex, and I just want, okay, fine. It's kind of difficult to use, to be honest, but yeah, so your normal distance is gonna be the normal distance. And so it shows you X, Y, and then also I think the shortest distance too, which is this black line. And so sometimes they're gonna be the same, but as long as you know what your axes you're using are, which they can change from part to part. So in this case, if we wanted the vertical distance, it would be dy, and you can see it's 6.95 millimeters or whatever inches. And so then you can still delete specific ones or clear all of them and kind of move around your part. You can even select like this line here, maybe, there we go, this line, and that line. And so sometimes it'll get mad if you're like trying to select something funky, but other than that, it's a pretty good tool. And I actually haven't used much of these, but oh yes, an arc and circle measurements. So if you wanted to measure like to the center of this from here, so it's going to show you that distance to the center. But if you wanted to the edge, then you can change, so like minimum distance, maximum, and then you can select like a specific point too. Does that make sense?
Yep.
Okay, thank you. I haven't done like a workshop like this without being in person, so this is fun. So just keeping that in mind when you are doing like circles, that you can change that by going to this tool. I'm gonna go back center to center. So I don't know, measurement history. I don't know what these mean. Point to point, it's probably pretty obvious, but. Oh, interesting. Now I'm just messing around to see what things do. What does this mean? Does anyone see this, please?
A great question.
I don't even know what that means.
What did you do?
I clicked on a face and then I clicked this create sensor.
Neat.
And it says, please.
Good job, SolidWorks.
Okay, I'm just gonna forget that ever happened. No, leave me alone. Stop. Okay. Oh no. I don't know how to make it stop. Can I just leave?
The lesson here is don't click that button.
Click that button. Okay.
Wow.
Take a moment and just, there we go. BRB. Wow, we learned something today.
I have a question while we're waiting.
Yes.
So on the frames, it has, like cutouts of the letters of the parts. Are those going to get printed on there as well? Or are those just so we know, like while we're looking at the part in SolidWorks? That makes sense.
Yeah, those get engraved on.
Okay, cool.
Which brings up a good point. So can everyone see again?
Yep.
Okay, so if you look, you're talking about these, right? So if you look, you can see that there's quite a significant distance here, and that is so that that bit can get in and actually engrave those out without hitting the wall. So, so that was measuring, and Melissa wanted to see macros, and I totally forgot. I actually don't know what macros are. I was going to look it up. So, sorry, Melissa, she's not on. Okay. Everything else can kind of go in whatever order. So, we'll just walk through making a part similar to the frame. And so for this, I wanted to cover a couple different things, and I'll start with patterns. So let's say I'm making kind of a really janky frame. So making, and I don't care what dimensions. And actually what I'm gonna do is show you guys what happens when things go wrong. So we're gonna over define this. Oh no, it's mad at me. Okay, so say that you are trying to get this fully defined and something like this happens. Does anyone know what I should do?
You can press the thing on the bottom that says no solution and it will come up with solutions for you. I don't know if that's the right answer, but that's what I do.
So you did that. Sometimes it can take a while, but
I had no idea that was there.
So
like deleting the bad ones until you're doing it.
So yeah, there's different ways to do it. Yeah, it does. Did everyone see what I did?
Yeah.
Did anyone not see? Okay, cool. So yeah, so I diagnosed it and it came up with apparently 28 different solutions, which, yeah, basically what happened was I made these vertical when they are not. So that's good because then I can just go in and delete them. But now it looks like this. So sometimes things don't quite go the way that you want them to. And yeah, that's not what I wanted. So the other way is you can just hit undo. But if you do it again, because you really want them to be vertical for some reason and you really can't figure out what went wrong, or maybe doing that didn't work, you can also go in and select these relations and you can delete some of them. So the ones in red mean really bad. And so I'm going to maybe right click on it and delete and go down here, click and then right click, delete. And so that's another way to do it. And another way, you just joined. Oh, Alex is on. Hey, okay. So now I'll say that maybe we didn't want to do it that way, but we want to see what all constraints this line has. So then you can even just click on that line and see, oh, okay, vertical. It shouldn't be vertical. I'll delete that one. And this one is also red, so we can do the same. So there's a lot of different ways to get kind of the same thing, but now maybe you don't know what's wrong with it. You know that it's not fully defined because it says underdefined here. And this one is, it's obviously much more clear, but if it, pretend that it's like a really busy sketch and there's a lot going on. So what I usually do is I just click on it and see what happens. And that made it look funny, but I don't know, that's weird. But yeah, so you can click on things and see what moves. And so we can see that because this is getting shorter, like bigger and smaller, then we know that this line needs to be dimensioned. Which I hate how SolidWorks makes it black when I feel like these should be, because these have a dimension. I feel like it's backwards, but that's fine. So, and you can also display your relations and go through and delete specific ones. So like I said, there's a ton of different ways to do things. And you can also hit repair sketch if it is overdefined again. So up here, it might be hidden under my little zoom bar, but right here, repair sketch. And you can select it showing gaps smaller than whatever. And so that will just show, like, sometimes if you have, if you're trying to make a box, but it doesn't quite become a box, but sometimes it's hard to tell because you're like really zoomed out, it's really big or something, or really small. And so if your lines just like aren't quite meeting, then it will show that, which is a really big thing that people miss sometimes. So. Anything on that we want to cover before we move on? No? Okay. Okay, so then the next thing I want to do is both mirror entities and the sketch pattern. And so this one is probably one that you all have used before, but they're both really fun to do. When we had the girls ink intern, they were trying to make this star and they worked on it for like 2 days and I was like, you should just mirror it. It's so much easier. So I'm going to, this is not a frame anymore. I don't know what this is, but I'll just show you some fun ways that I like to constrain things. So actually when I even put that circle in, I like subconsciously wanted it on this line. So when I placed it, it kind of snapped into place. And so that constraint is already there, that coincident, but you can delete that if you don't want it on there. You can move it, but then it might snap back into place again. So sometimes that is kind of frustrating, but I want it on that line. And then say I want it to be right above, actually, I don't want it on that line. I changed my mind. I want it to be right here. So what I can do is with that center point selected, I can come down and then press Control on my keyboard and then click the origin. And then I'm going to say we're in the Y direction. So that's vertical. I believe X and Z are horizontal and Y is vertical, I think. But Z might be vertical too. It's one of those. So vertical. And now we can only move up and down. And so that just makes it a little bit easier than having to make a whole nother center line, which is the other way that you can do it. And then I want to place it. That one doesn't have a point. Well, this one I'll just do. Smart dimension. So you can do that with midpoints of lines. You can make them midpoint, all that fun stuff. And make it, so now I want to mirror it to the other side so that I'm not having to do all of that again, which I only had two dimensions, but which isn't that bad, but sometimes it can be worse. So I want to mirror, going to select it. And because of how I made this part, I can then just mirror it about the top plane. So I don't need to make a whole new line, which you would have to do if I didn't make this centered about the origin. If anyone needs, if I'm like going too fast or anything, like say something, because sometimes it feels like I'm talking to myself. So I kind of lose track of what I'm doing. But yeah, so that was mirroring it. And then let's say I want to do a linear sketch pattern. So you can do a circular one too, which I think we only have in the OreSat assembly. But I'm going to do a sketch pattern, which we have quite a bit in the frames. And the reason why I'm showing the sketch pattern is because it came up about how to go back and edit it, because it's a lot easier to edit an assembly pattern than it is to edit a sketch pattern. And so I want to do it in, sure, the X direction. And a really important thing when you're doing a pattern is you have to click dimension X spacing or it won't be fully defined. I don't know why SolidWorks thinks that we don't want it dimensioned when we have a dimension right here. It just seems strange. And so I want, yeah, two instances and entities to pattern this guy and this guy. And we'll increase it to 2 inches. And then I want it going the other way too. So instead of x-axis, I'm just gonna say this way. And no, stop it. That way. And flip. Theoretically.
I think it's patterning the line that you tried to use as your dimension line.
Delete. Okay, there we go. This way. Oh. Well, I don't know why it's giving me a hard time. There. Direction two. The other way.
Oh, what it might be doing is it might not let you do something in the sketch. Like it has to be like either a different sketch or a surface.
Usually I can do the line. Why?
It's if just it's going... in the same sketch, I don't know. Being yeah. weird.
It's just going like the opposite direction from what I like perpendicular. Maybe because we've already got. Nope. Okay. Oh, well. That's fine. So we just have the two, and then you can select instances to skip. So maybe I just want one of these repeated for some reason. So I can select, why is it being weird? I don't know why it's being weird right now. Do you see that there's like the stars up here? I'm so confused. Okay, I'm gonna start over. Well, normally what happens is you can select one of these there should be a little dot that you can select and then, but it's just not doing anything that I want it to do today. Emilio, you know what I'm talking about.
Yeah, I do. I don't know what's happening here. It's being real weird.
Oh, the dots are there. Okay, that's weird. So normally there would be like a dot in the center of this, but maybe because I did both of them. Let me delete one. So you can't really tell, but there's like dots on this line. And so if you wanted to, when you go down to instances to skip, the dots come up. So you can click on one of these dots, these little tiny pink dots, and you can add or delete these instances like that. So just like that. And so if you wanted to have like these six, so like two more down here, you could either do what I did where I mirrored it for first and then did a sketch pattern, or you could do the sketch pattern and then mirror it. So either way. And then let's do extrude. And yeah, so then you can also select which ones you want to extrude. So you could say just these three little circles, or maybe just the square and that circle and not that one. So that's how you pick if you don't have them as sketch entities. So, yep. So that's how that works. And then if you wanted to edit it, you can go back in to the sketch and say that now I want to, I don't know, maybe add more or change it somehow. So notice that there's nothing in here that says that you've done a sketch pattern. We're editing the sketch, but there's really no good way to tell other than the fact that you've got this four here. So that is our signal that we've done a sketch pattern. And so then the way to go back and edit it is, hold on. You can show your relations theoretically, and you've got this patterned here. And if you right click on it, you can edit pattern. Did everyone catch that?
Yeah.
Yep.
Cool. Yep. Okay. I am getting a call. Give me 2 seconds. Sorry, it was just my stepmom asking me if I wanted a milkshake. I thought it was going to be bigger than that. Anyways.
I hope you said yes.
I said no because I got this Pop-Tart thing from Pine State Biscuits today that I haven't eaten yet. If you've been to Pine State Biscuits, you know what I mean. anyways, so yeah, so that's how you edit the sketch pattern. So it's a little bit more convoluted than if you were to do a pattern in like your, like an entity pattern, which I'll show you. So we want, so now we're in this features instead of sketch. We were in sketch before. Oh, no. Stop it. Oh no, go back. How do I make it go back? Emilio, help.
Hold on. I'm trying to figure out how you did that.
I like clicked on it, bunny.
Try dragging it to like the top left wall.
It's just, it's all worse. This? Oh no. Oh, okay. We're good. Okay, so linear pattern in features. And so now you've actually got a lot more options, whereas before we only had linear and circular pattern, and then mirror was separate, which it's separate here too. But you can do curve-driven, sketch-driven, you can do a bunch of crazy stuff. I don't know if I've ever used most of these, but if we wanted to then do this linear pattern of, it's actually probably going to be a bit more difficult to do, to show in this, but you can select specific features and bases to pattern.
Or we've bodies. Only,
what?
Or solid bodies, actually, which is useful.
Yeah, or solid bodies. So because we've only got this one boss extrude, it can't really show you how useful it is.
I think you can do it with the, there's two solid bodies that, that one circle to the right should work.
No, it's going to be the whole
thing. You'll need to go into the solid bodies tab in the feature tree that pops down now.
Solid bodies. That one. Cool.
Yeah.
Maybe.
Oh, you'll need to select them. Instead of select feature and faces, you select. Yeah.
Cool. Not that one. So yeah, you can do features and faces. You can do, oh, I totally didn't mention this, but when you're doing something like this, where your feature tree goes away because you're in whatever linear pattern, you still have your secondary feature tree here. And so sometimes it won't, sometimes it likes to be a little funky, which is hard to explain, but so you can go through here and select specific things. So this comes in handy if you want to mirror about a top plane or select specific features and faces, which is also why it's useful to name them, like with the frames, because things get kind of crazy. So this way you don't have to select like just the circle, you can select it things in here. So it would just, it usually like looks like that, and you just click the little caret to make things pop up. And then you can select instances to skip. We've got, what are we doing? We need a direction. We'll do it that way. And 3 inches, 10 instances, because why not? And then let's skip a couple. So this is what I mean by the dots. So you can go through and select which ones you want to skip or include. And we use this a lot in OreSat because we have things that are like a specific distance apart. And then, sure. So now you can see it actually shows that we've got a pattern here. So to edit that, it's a lot easier. You do it just how you normally would. You can right click and do edit pattern. So that one is much, much easier to change. So some people prefer doing it that way. I don't think I've ever come across an instance where it was like necessary to do it one way or another, except maybe for this, because we just wanted, but I don't know when you would ever make a part that looks like this. If you do, you're doing something wrong. So really you could do it either way. I think it's just a personal preference and how you think of it. I don't know, Emilio, if you feel differently, but.
No, I think it usually goes down to personal preference. It is it's worth mentioning that you can do linear patterns and assemblies too with multiple parts, like we do with the triangles and wedges in the framed assembly.
Yeah. Yeah, so I had the frames up at one point.
And you can also do, these also work very similar with something like circular patterns or mirrors.
Yeah, so to speak on that, once this loads, the frames are actually for three configurations of one part. And then to make the assembly, it's a circular pattern of so the wedges and triangles have a linear pattern going down the frames, and then we've got the circular pattern going around to the three, if that makes sense. So maybe I'll show you. Why is this, it's doing all sorts of weird stuff today. So yeah, this was actually two linear patterns, one going down, one going up, and then you do a circular pattern around. So like that. Except actually this frame is different now, but we just skipped that one. So these two, and you could mirror it, I suppose, but yeah. So that is patterns, and then we covered editing it. So now we can talk about mass, finding the mass of something. So I'm gonna go back into the frames assembly, theoretically. You guys only see SolidWorks right now, right?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah, that's funny. I opened up, there we go. Okay. So you guys can see the frames?
Yep.
Yep.
Cool, okay. It's so funny how that works. Okay, mass, right. Mass properties. So we've got a big hefty assembly here. And we want to know, for this one, there's not too many different parts. I have used what I'm going to show you eventually, more so in OreSat full assembly, that down there. So I like to keep this little search bar under search commands. So if you click on this little caret here, you can pick different things that you want to search into. I think the default is SolidWorks help. I don't know if I've ever used SolidWorks help because I just Google things on my own. So I just leave it under commands. And then you can search for things. I think actually mass properties is under evaluate, but I never go there. I usually just type in mass properties. You can do it either way. And then it's going to show you your mass, volume, surface area, center of mass, principal axes of inertia and principal moments of inertia, all that fun stuff, things that I do not remember the purpose of because it's been a long time for me since I took physics, but Corey likes them. So sometimes people want to know these things, and you can find all of that just by searching for the mass properties. And you can do this on a part as well. And so if you were in a specific part or assembly that maybe you bought off the shelf and you don't know the density of that part, because you don't want to stick it in water and find out, you can just weigh it and then override the mass properties. So sometimes for most of our parts, we just put in the material and then it just gives us the mass because maybe we haven't made it yet, and we still want that initial mass estimate. And so then SolidWorks does that for us, but then we can just override the mass for things that we don't know, or we do know the mass specifically, so we just want to put that in.
Yeah, stuff like the turnstile antennas, I know we have to override the mass properties because there's no material property on there for what we're making, for specifically what we're making.
Right, exactly. Yeah, so cameras, because they're like a camera lens is a mixture of glass and plastic, like which one do you choose, right? Like the glass is probably going to outweigh it, but you still have to keep into account the plastic. So it's just easier to just stick it on a scale or ask Andrew what the mass is. And then the center of mass. So this is why it's super important to make sure that your assembly for OreSat matches the axes in OreSat matches the axes that we need for the CSLI, CDS. So most of the time you probably don't care, but the CDS gives us very specific center of mass requirements and based on X, Y, and Z. So we have to make sure that our OreSat full assembly axes match the ones in the CDS so that we can find that center of mass. So this is actually wrong. Because this isn't the full OreSat, it's okay. Because we don't care about the center of mass of just the frames. And then the other important thing is this assembly visualization. So I'm going to click on that, and I use this in full OreSat because you are able to then go right away and see right here which components don't have a mass. And these all do because I've gone in and put in the densities for all of these fasteners, but McMaster Car, when you save a part from McMaster Car's website, it won't automatically come with the material. So if you are like me with my previous stuff, and you don't think about putting that in because you're just trying to get the fasteners in right away. And so then you forget to go in and put that material property in. So instead of having to like go through and open all of these parts one by one, we can just quickly use this assembly visualization tool to see in order of heaviest to lightest what those masses are. And then we can say, oh, and usually you'd see like this one is zero. Because I made it zero, so you can go in and open them up. However, there's kind of a caveat because there is a automatic density applied to your materials, and you have to go in and change that. So I've gone in and changed my SolidWorks to apply a density of basically zero, because otherwise it applies a density of water. And so then even your McMaster Car parts are going to show a weight because a SolidWorks assumes that they have a density equivalent to water, which is false. So sometimes you'll see parts that have a mass, and if you don't know that you have not specifically put in a material, and it will just say like material. It won't say a specific material on the side, which I can show you. So here we've got 6061T6SS. So if you haven't selected a specific material, it's just going to say material there, but it will still give you a mass. So if you see that, then you know that something is wrong. Because if you haven't put in a material, you would think that it would just show zero mass, but SolidWorks doesn't work that way. So always be careful. Yeah, that was a lot of talking, but yeah. So that was a fun tool. How to make folders in Feature Tree. Yeah. So that's a good segue as we have the frame open. So folders are fun because you can organize things a lot better. And let's see, we'll go back to my part here. So we've got our boss extrude and our linear pattern. And we can right click on it, on our boss extrude, and say add to new folder. And we'll just call it, we'll name it Emmy. And not to call out Emmy, but and then you can click on whatever you want to put into it, and it's going to have this funky little arrow here that says move to Emmy, and you can move it in there. So now everything is in that folder. And we can also rename these, rename tree item, and we'll say square. And we can rename this to circles. And so these are kind of optional. I think with OreSat parts, depending on who made it, you might get, like me, some of my parts are like really in-depth named. Ryan, who originally made the frames, has like his folders named, but then everything else is just like cut, extrude. So it depends on like how much time you want to put into it and how much you want someone else to have guidance. And so it's useful if you know someone else is going to be looking at your part, or if you know like an OreSat, none of us stick around for more than a couple years. So it's just nice so that whoever comes after you can look through and really get a better feel than having to like sit here and be like, what fillets are these, and what is this cut extrude, what does that do, and or like trying to click on things and figure out where they are. I think we've all been there. So yeah.
So Catie, what if I make a new feature? I need to add it to this folder, but it's at the bottom of the feature tree and I can't drag it up.
Yeah, so sometimes that happens. If this cut extrude has a sketch that is built off of this line. So obviously like this little slot here is tangent to this line. And so if we made that sketch that way, we wouldn't be able to move this cut extrude. Yeah, so change would put child feature above its parent feature. So what that means is that sketch is reliant on something. And so basically what you would have to do, from what I know, Emilio, you can step into, but you can change the sketch to be referencing something above wherever it won't go above. So you could reference maybe this side instead, if you wanted to put it in a different folder. Sometimes you can move things down too. So you can see I can move this cutout down, all the way down to there. So yeah, you can move things around. It's usually easier to move things down than up, I think, but yeah, so you would just have to check your constraints, references, all those kinds of things. Emilio, do you agree?
Yeah, I agree. What I usually do is do the rollback function. So I roll back till I'm like, I roll everything back like below that folder that I want to edit. And then I can just edit the folder fairly freely and not.
Yeah, that's
like, obviously
good point.
You lose some features and you can't like reference to them, but if you reference to them, you'll be able to edit the folder. So.
Right, that's a good point. So I like to use this too, especially for these complicated parts where I know that I want to change like one specific thing. And instead of, especially because parts like these, a lot of things are kind of referenced off each other, like fillets. I know based on my knowledge of fillets that if I change like these sides somehow, this fillet is gonna like yell at me and give me an error. And if you're like me, you probably are tired of SolidWorks giving you errors. So the easiest way to like say, I don't care about that for now, is just roll back to above it. And so it's not going to give you errors for any of this stuff until you roll below it. So then if you change, like maybe we change this first sketch here, you can roll back all the way to that sketch, change it, and then go one by one and see, well, what changed? What do I need to go back and fix?
That's literally what I did for the 1U frames, is rolled back to the very beginning and just kind of went through and fixed everything that broke.
Yeah, exactly. So
it's also really good if you have like a really big feature tree and a whole bunch of unnamed features, and you kind of need to find where something is in the feature tree to edit it. Just like roll back about halfway up, and if it disappears, then you roll forward. If it's still there, then you roll back farther until it's gone and kind of home in on it.
Yeah, exactly. Completely agree. So big fan of the rollback. Can use that a lot. The one thing that I would note, though, is sometimes, especially for this, because we've got configurations, which is why so much is suppressed, sometimes it won't, like if you suppress one thing on its own, it just like gets kind of funky. So just like make sure that you know what should be unsuppressing when you roll back, if that makes sense, because sometimes it will stay suppressed depending on like what else you've done. So let me see if I can show an example. Yeah, so I suppressed just this cut extrude and all the others became unsuppressed. And so then if I were to like edit it, sometimes they don't all unsuppress with it. Yeah.
So you suppressed a parent feature and all of its like child features were also suppressed too, because they wouldn't make sense without it.
Yeah, but then when I unsuppressed it, they stayed suppressed.
Yeah.
So that is something kind of funky too. Let me see if I can go back and
show. I haven't had all. Good. No, I did. But...
yeah. See, so all of those became suppressed when I suppressed it, and then I unsuppressed, and it was just the one. So yeah, keep that in mind. Just keep an eye if you aren't rolling back. I think sometimes if you are, sometimes things can get funky. So don't trust SolidWorks, basically. Don't ever trust SolidWorks to do things for you. Always, always double, triple check what you're doing. And then going into configurations real quick. So configurations are super helpful if you know how to use them properly. I would say don't ever feel like you need to use them, even if someone tells you to, unless it's like literally your job and you're going to get fired if you don't listen to them. But if you're not comfortable with them, then you might make things worse. But again, the only way to get better is to practice. But the point of them is you can have this base geometry that everything is based off of. And so that's why some of these things are suppressed and some of them aren't. So we've got like a general shape here. And if I go to the positive X frame, we know that both the positive X and the negative X both need pillars. And so those pillars can be the same in both of them without me having to make a whole new part. I didn't make these frames, so I probably would have just made separate parts, but Ryan is a big fan of configuration, so he made them configurations. And
I actually could do a little configuration demo if you want. I have it set up here.
Yeah, go ahead. I'll stop sharing.
Give me permission to share my screen.
Oh, hold on. I always click the wrong thing. Okay.
You can also just make me co-host or whatever. Okay. So behold, I have some little smiley face I've made. Now say I want to have two versions of this, one with a smiley face and one with a frowny face. Now to design for that, I'm going to make like a slight design change. If I was just doing this as quick as possible, I might like the eyes and the mouth kind of all in one sketch. But because the mouth is going to be changing, I currently have the mouth as one sketch and the eyes as a different one. So I'll make a new configuration. Let's say make a new derived configuration of default. Let's do frowny face. And because there's going to be two now, I'm going to add a second one. That's smiley face. OK. currently in smiley face. Switch to frowny face, and now I can start removing stuff. So we don't want this, so I'll suppress it in this configuration. It still exists in smiley face, but it's suppressed in frowny face. And then now, I'll make my little frown real quick.
How fast I can do that. Does anyone want Emilio to send this to you and you can do it with us? I just realized that we've just been kind of talking, but if you guys want us to like do something with you, just let us know.
I can set out this file pretty quickly if you want. But the general idea of this is pretty, I don't know, simple almost, or like it's pretty generally applicable. It's kind of a sad frowny face. And there's my shape. Now this one, we'll set it up to extruded cut. And sure. And there's the frowny face. Looks really sad. So that's the general point of features, is that there are common elements of both these configurations, but they have specific different parts. And now it's pretty easy to switch between them. Additionally, there's also, I think, this default configuration we'll show you. So default is the... Yeah, so default currently is set to big smile. But what I've seen people do before is they do all of their general geometry, and that's their default configuration, and then their specific geometry for the configurations is in the specific configuration.
Yeah, so you can configure feature. I don't know if you showed that. I went to get water. But if you right click on it, you can configure.
Oh, yeah, that's a good one too.
Yeah. And so. The third one in the list. Yeah.
Figure feature. Yeah, whatever, SolidWorks. So this will actually show you where, which configurations it's suppressed and which configurations it's active in. And I can change it from here too. Say I want a really well, I have a messed up smiley face, but I can like add this feature to the smiley face where it's normally suppressed, now it's unsuppressed. And then we'll have a... Oh, interesting. It actually moved the suppress this one too. Okay. Yeah. Anyway.
So yeah, that's why if you know how to use it, it can be really powerful, but it does take some getting used to. And also that little warning that showed up when Emilio when he clicked configure feature, that always shows up. I couldn't even tell you what it says. I always ignore it.
Yeah, same. It lost the text file or the properties file or something. So it just got angry at me.
Yeah, it's like for everyone though. It's so weird. So just ignore it. It's not going to make any difference. And honestly, every time I get any warning from SolidWorks, I ignore it. Like, I don't care about any of their warnings because it's going to show you and you'll be able to tell if something is not what you want it to be. Yeah. So I think the only time is when it's like those pop-ups, like that, the ones that aren't like a select, but it'll be like, this won't work, like if you're trying to do an extrude or something. Those are the only ones I look at, but they don't have like little buttons that say like okay or not. But yeah, so don't ever like get freaked out by a SolidWorks warning, because I don't even pay attention to them.
Oh, let me share one thing that I learned about that's really great, which is this normal to button, which you can add to your little toolbar, which like they're at a weird angle, you want to sketch it, you click the surface and click normal to. It's super nice. You can do it by hitting the customize button, and you go to commands and standard views, and it's right in here, and you can just drag it up to where you want it. Highly recommend it.
You can also right click on specific bases and become normal to them.
Look at that.
Yep. Also, if you click on your sketch for the boss extrude, right click on it, you can become normal to the sketch too. Also,
we'll always be normal.
Yes, plenty of ways to be normal. Also, if you press the space bar, you can
the orientation
use.
Tab.
Yep. Also, when I took my SolidWorks class, my professor was, and that was at PCC, which I highly recommend. I have not heard great things about the one at PSU, but PCC was great. But anyways, the professor there really liked keyboard shortcuts, so you can personalize those. I don't remember how, but if you are the kind of person who loves keyboard shortcuts, then you can set it up to do anything by just clicking like any letter or combination of letters and keys on your keyboard. So whatever makes sense to you.
I believe that currently, like,
I've
never used keyboard shortcuts specifically, but I know that like Control 1 and like Control 2, Control 3, basically Control and then a number switches you through standard views. And it's actually useful if you like Control 7 is particularly useful for me because that's just basic isometric view. If you've somehow gotten like, who knows where, where's your part? I don't know. Control 7, and then we'll get back to it.
That's when I click the space bar. Yeah. Yeah. And some of them are typical Windows ones. If you were using Word, like Control S is save, you've got your file edit view tab. So a lot of it is similar to Windows, but you can change them. So I think I actually changed mine to like S would be sketch or something. So I did use them for a little bit, but it's up to
you.
That's
kind of useful.
Yeah. So a lot of ways to customize it. and let's see. Oh, SolidWorks. Another thing too is cut through or a section view. I just call it a cut through. but this one, so if we were in an assembly, is usually when I use it. And especially, this is very, very PSAS specific because Andrew loves to look at things, right? But he doesn't really know how to communicate that well. So if you are showing Andrew a part, which I think Emily has recently learned too, he'll want to look at things, and Andrew doesn't fully understand SolidWorks. And so he might tell you to like hide things. So there's many different ways that you can show or hide things. This is all mad at me now. But I have like this frame hidden. So you can either select it in the feature tree. You would right click, select hide. You can click on it directly and select hide. In this assembly, it's a little bit more different than if you were looking at it in OreSat, because in OreSat, you would have the frames as one subassembly that you could then hide. Let's see if it'll do it. Yeah, so you could hide all of them or show all of them. Oh.
Whoa.
Yeah, that's that
guy.
Oh,
the CDS design spec.
Yeah. Or you can change the transparency. So this one is Oleg's favorite one, change transparency. And so you can still tell that it's there if you needed to do that. Sometimes it's good for screenshots just because people might be like, well, where did it go? Well, it's still there. I just wanted to show you something else. Or my favorite, I don't usually like to do those. I like to just do the section view, and I start by clicking on whichever way I want it sectioned. So like that face, and then I'll click this little half donut, and you can drag it in and out. And then you can go as far as you want. The thing to note with that is if you, I don't know if you guys will ever, ever experience this, but it happens to me a lot where I have a section view and then I put in a new component. That component's going to be cut off. So if you then wanted to show that component before you've placed it in, then you can do section by component and then select in your feature tree like a specific thing, like maybe we want I don't know, this is a bad example, but we want like another wedge that's out somewhere, then it won't be cut through. Are you gonna do it? yeah, this is a bad example, but I think you get the idea. So you can, so this section by component just means that you're not going to cut through that part. You'll cut through everything else normal, but then you might have like another part out here that would normally be cut through, if that makes sense. And then another thing, which I was telling Emmy about a couple weeks ago, I personally like shaded with edges because I really like seeing these edges for some reason. No edges just looks gross to me. It just doesn't look right. I like those edges. But you can also do, so I want to do a coloring book for PSAS, and that's how I would do it. if I ever get around to it, I would just do that. You can show that, which shows you everything that's going on. I don't like that. I probably would never use that. And this is even worse. So that's what I stick to. Sometimes SolidWorks will automatically kick you back into this for some reason. And I just go back. And then if you wanted to, you can go to view, hide show, and there's a bunch of different things that you can see. And so normally we don't have the sketches shown, but sometimes you need to see them. So if a sketch like won't show up, you've hidden it and shown it and it still doesn't want to show up, usually you have to go through here and show your sketches. You can also see axes, and they're usually, so this came in handy for, it's not showing up in here, but it can show you the axes in these little holes too, which is good for sometimes for mating, depending on what you're doing. And then we can go back and hide and show and hide all types, and then it just looks normal. So that's a good thing too. And what else is on my list? Ah, yes, okay. So now I'm going to do a little demo on split bodies and converting and offsetting entities. Maybe if I can get back into SolidWorks. Okay. So let's say we then decide that we, or actually, Emilio, you split bodies on your clamps, right?
Yeah, on the two-part mount clamp.
You want to show it?
Sure. It's a little bit of a weirder one because I used a, pull it up. Yeah, it was a slightly weird split body because I split it with a surface. But I think it'll work as an example.
Okay.
Okay, so I'm gonna, you know, actually right there. So what I did for this, and this is like almost the intro to surfaces, is I have, we'll just say this is a surface. You can split with a plane, right? I don't think I've done that in a while, but.
Yeah, you can do sketches and planes, I think.
Okay. So what I have here is a surface that's intersecting. It's one surface, it goes through here and then intersects fully through the body. And what I did to break it was, I don't remember where it is in the features, but I think, is it insert feature and split? Yeah, it is in there. Yeah. So we'll like pretend this isn't here. So right now if I hide my surface, it's just a solid thing, there's nothing going on. But the surface exists, so I can insert feature and then activate split body using this. And when I target body, you can select a specific body. If they say about a bunch of different bodies in close proximity to each other and you only want to cut one of them, you can select the specific body, but I don't care, I just want all of them. So I'll hit cut bodies. All right, so it's cut them. It's by slicing them, it's created one body into two. And I want to keep them. save those. And if I want to delete them, like, I think I can hit consume cut body, but I will hit check. And it's going to keep those two. If I did not hit check, then they would delete the ones that I hadn't saved. And at this point, I can hide whatever surface or plane I used. And now there are different bodies, and I can hide them individually and then also assign them to separate parts if I needed to, which is what I eventually did. And to do that, I think it was right-click on the solid body, and I think I hit insert into new part. That'll basically save it for me. I could choose the file name right here. Any questions about that?
Nope.
Cool beans.
Cool. So, yeah, I don't have it open, but we used that. Emmy and I used it for the OreSat Live to make a shim because it basically needed to be like right up against the lens. And we also use something called convert entities. And this one I actually cover. We have a video on our YouTube of making a card for OreSat, but I'll cover it again here for a similar application. But so let's say you've got this card assembly, and I already have the cutouts that I need in it, but let's pretend that I want instead to cut out a square around the leg of this mount. And so I could do that the normal way where I would just sketch on the card and put in all my dimensions and cut it out, which there is nothing wrong with that. But we like to do the convert entities so that it's based off of something specific rather than just your sketch, which maybe you get like the dimensions wrong or something, and things can go wrong with that. So the way that I'm going to do it is first move this away, but I'm still going to keep it mostly mated. I'm just going to remove the mate that keeps it coincident to the board, and I'm just going to suppress it. So what that means is now I can move it up and down. And that's important because sometimes when we do this, it can be hard to select things, which will make sense in a second. But now, because I've already got some cuts in this board, I can show you what I mean by that. But basically, you would go through, I'll just show you how. So then you want to open the part that you want that cut through in. And so you can see I've got two cut extrudes that I did the same way. And I'm in the part file. And I have to, this is important, you have to make the sketch in that part file. Don't make the sketch in the assembly. So now I'm just going to make a sketch like I normally would. But in this case, it doesn't matter what I'm putting in it just now. We just can't save it and open it in the previous CFC assembly without like a circle or something in the sketch. So you can't have an empty sketch, basically. So just entering, and so we've got sketch 9 here. It's underdefined. That is fine for right now. That is the only time I'm going to say that. And I'm going back into my CFC assembly. And let me know if I'm going too fast too. But this is also in one of our videos too. And so now that I'm in the assembly, I'm going to edit that sketch. And so this is what I mean by now it's going to be kind of hard to click on things. So now I can delete that circle. I don't need that anymore. And now I'm going to convert entities. So right here, convert entities. And once you click on that, you can select a bunch of stuff. And so the reason why we moved it far away was because if it was on the board, it would look like this, and then you can't select these lines, if that makes sense. So it's easier when you can see them off in space. And so I want a little cut through for this leg, and only this leg for some reason. that I decided. And so I've got all those edges selected. And when I hit the green check mark, we've now got the sketch here on our board. So it kind of just like projected it on. And so now I'm fine. That's all I wanted. So I'm just kind of entering out. And then I am going to unsuppress my mate. So it's back on the board and we are back where we were. Now I'm going to go back to that card file or whatever file you're using and go back into the sketch. Now, because I want this leg to go through the board, I'm creating a cutout. I want some clearance. And to do that, I'm going to just select all of those at once and go and click this offset entities. And so now you can offset it by however much you want. You can also do this for creating walls. So if you, I made like a box for something and I just started with a square and then I wanted walls of like 0.2 inches or something. So you can just offset them and then extrude in between like these two sketches then. And that would give you a wall. But for what we're doing, we want our base geometry to be construction geometry. And then we want a clearance of like 0.2 millimeters. You can also reverse if you want it inside for some reason, but we want it outside. And so now that original sketch that we converted entities from, that original dimensions of the leg, is construction. So that if we wanted to then cut this out, it's with that 0.2 millimeter offset. And you can even, it makes it really easy to just go back and change that offset dimension in the future. So that's converting and offsetting entities. We also use the convert entities to do that split bodies for the OreSat Live stuff. We just converted the lens onto, like the diameter of the lens onto a plane. And then we made a body up to the lens and then split it, if that makes sense. But yeah, so a bunch of fun different things that you can do with it. Does that make sense to everyone? Does anyone need me to repeat anything?
Sounds good.
Cool. Okay. And there's probably a bunch of different ways to do things. Like looking at it, there was like, I left SolidWorks real quick so you can't see, but there's like shell and things like that that you can use. Let's see. So I think really the last thing then is different kinds of mates and assemblies. If I can get back in. Sure. This is a bad example. I don't have a good example up. Emilio, do you want to show the battery card?
Sure.
We can talk through. I'll pull it up. Because I haven't pulled if you changed it. And there's a bunch of like cool mates in the battery and inhibit switch assembly.
Yeah, I can pull that up. Well, there were. I had to change a decent chunk of them. What mates were you trying to show off?
Like the slot and stuff.
Okay.
Does it still move? Can you get it to move?
I made configurations that don't move. Because okay. The moving was breaking everything.
Okay.
But I did save the one with everything that moved. So.
Okay, cool. And then also show how to like make it flexible in OreSat. Also, some of the things that we're covering, I took the LinkedIn SolidWorks assessment, and some of these things are in that assessment, by the way.
Oh, really?
So, yeah. So y'all can take it and get LinkedIn SolidWorks certified.
So here we are. This thing has a couple interesting mates. It's got like a specific distance one. Where are the sliding one? Oh, the sliding ones are in the subassembly specifically. Let me pull that up. Okay, we'll switch over to this. Here are the cool mates. This is the inhibit switch subassembly, which we use to basically turn off the satellite while it's in the launching rails. And if I remember correctly, the cool thing about this is that, let me switch back to the default one. Everything's actually properly defined. Okay. So the cool thing about that is that Oleg made this so that it actually, it moves, it looks like it moves kind of awkwardly. That's just my computer being annoying. On a better computer, this would actually move fairly like smoothly. I don't know why it does that jerk. Anyway. And the way that was done was with something called a slot mate, which is in here. Yeah, right here. So the slot mate here. And what that, editing it right now. So you select the like the face of the slot that the thing is going to fit in. So basically the retaining wall, and then you select the rod that's going to be in the center. And then you can select the slot mate, and then that'll allow it to slide back and forth freely between those two. It's pretty cool, honestly. There's a lot of really cool mates in these like mechanical mates or advanced mates section. There's a lot of really interesting ways to kind of get movement to your parts or have them be like perfectly centered. What other cool mates are there in here?
Can you show like how to flip a mate?
Oh yeah, that's a great one. I'll pull up that same slot mate again. So sometimes when you mate something, it's just gonna be pointed the wrong direction. So there's this mate alignment button right down here. I can just click it and it'll sort of flip everything around. Now it's gonna try to, it's gonna need to flip a whole bunch of, it's not a very good example. Let me find a better one. Maybe over here. Yeah, this one will do. So it's gonna try to, when you mate something together, it's gonna try to make its best guess for which way these two, which way the two parts are supposed to be facing. It's not always correct though, so sometimes you'll need to flip it like this. Same button, and it's gonna wanna need to flip a whole bunch of other mates too, so it's taking a second. We broke another mate, so I'm just gonna flip that. Isn't it trying, letting me do that?
Is there distance?
There might.
Oh yeah, coincident. Well, coincident works too.
Coincident at the top line. Yeah, sure. It's gonna want to flip a whole bunch of other ones again. Okay, so I'm trying very hard to show off this flip. Right now, there we go. And yeah, it'll need to flip a whole bunch of other mates, but you can basically flip back and forth in case one of the parts ends up upside down by accident. And if that has to change any other mates, as sometimes it does, then it'll tell you. But it usually does that automatically. Anyway, sometimes you end up with like, sometimes I want to mate like a flat surface to another flat surface, but it decides that my flat surface is upside down and merged through the other flat surface. That's how you fix that.
Can you show what happens in the battery assembly if you want to make it move?
Yes. So what I did, so the moving was actually causing a little bit of problems. So what I did here, normally what you can do is, normally the subassembly is flexible.
I think normally it's rigid. I think I changed it to flexible.
You changed it? Okay. So what I did here then was, should be flexible, right?
Because normally, if you look at the, well, I think I changed that too.
Katie, if you have the old version, why don't you show this off? Because I changed this to stop breaking things on me.
Okay, let me try to open it. Right. So usually in SolidWorks, when you have a assembly inside an assembly, so a subassembly, it's going to make all your subassemblies rigid. And so what that means is, as Emilio has shown, this should be able to move, but it doesn't want to. So I can go in and right click on it, and maybe I changed it too. So normally, I don't know, it's kind of hard to show here, but you would then click make subassembly flexible. And by doing that, you would allow it to move, but we've gone in and messed with it. But I think you all get the idea. So normally this would then have the slots and be able to move in and out, but it doesn't want to because we've changed things. But basically, if you have those mates like slots or hinge, and you know that it should move, but it's not moving once you put it into another assembly, you just have to go and right click and change it to flexible, or you can flip it back to rigid, but that's how you do that. And that was in my SolidWorks LinkedIn assessment, if you take it. I don't know if it will be in yours, but yeah, so that's how that works. So a lot of fun different mates. Another good one is that you can make things symmetric. I don't know if this is
probably a hard example. Hard one to show in this part.
Yeah. I don't have anything good to show for it. But give me like basically, 5 minutes,
I'll put something together.
Okay. Basically, if you have like a box inside of another box, I don't know, and you want it to be like perfectly, like this one kind of makes sense because you've got this distance between this space and this space, and assuming that you want it the same over here, you can then select your two faces, so these two, and then the outer two, so four in total, and it will just make them all kind of symmetric about a line here. And you can do the same for like, if you had a center line, you could select that center line and then these two faces. Hopefully I made that make sense. But that just helps you so that you're not having to then go in and say, well, I know I want this to be exactly 0.2 millimeters. So then that one should hopefully be 0.2 because I made it 0.4 millimeters on both sides. So hopefully that will work. You don't have to like do the math. You can just say, I want this exactly centered in this little slot without doing like a slot feature because you don't want it to be a slot. You just want it with some clearance. So it's kind of like when you make this concentric, but not really. That makes sense. And a very important one is, this is a bad assembly, we know, but so sometimes with fasteners I see it a lot is they aren't fully defined. This one, oh yeah, so it's moving. It's not applicable here, but usually what would happen is you'd get this little negative sign and you've probably made it concentric and coincident to your board. But the last thing you have to do is make sure that it doesn't spin. So anything circular is going to want to spin. And so you can, when you made it, nowadays it gives you the option to like lock rotation, but you can also, I just lost my headphone, come back. You can also mate either a face of it, so if it's a hex nut, you can mate this face parallel to a line, so to that line, or you can go in if it's a fastener, and you can select like the top plane, wherever it is, top plane, and make it parallel to a face, and so then it won't rotate. So that's kind of the big one that I think people overlook is locking one of those faces in so it's not rotating around. And yeah, so that's all I had on my list. Now with 30 minutes left after going through things. Is there anything people want to see in particular? No? Trying to think of other cool stuff. You can make a plane. I guess that's kind of fun. I always do the blue one. And you can make it parallel to something by a certain amount. Or you can make it like halfway between two faces. If you need it for some reason. You can also make it perpendicular, which I've got two, so it won't let me. But yeah, cool things like that so that you can create separate sketches, which I think we've done a couple of times. That's about all I can think of. I've got one more cool thing that I'll show you. So I had to remake a part for CFC. Oh, you know what? I got rid of it actually because we didn't need it anymore. But that's okay. Let's say, so in the previous version of this, we didn't have, these little pins looked more like kind of S curves. And to do that, let's say we want to make one. Let's see if I can remember how to do it. So you can extrude like a curve to make it look like a wire. And we'll do like that. And then normally you would probably make, I'll just go through it. I don't know why I just say things like I can't show you guys. So if we want this to be a wire that's going to be flat on the board, then we would make this line horizontal and then make these two tangent. And then like that. So now it's going to come and be flat against the board, if that makes sense. And then once you've got that sketch, so this is kind of the direction that we want the wire to go. And now I'm going to, leave me alone. Now I'm going to go in and I would actually make a new plane here where this hits, but I'm not going to do that. I'm too lazy. I'm going to make a new sketch. And create this circle that I'm going to then make coincident, hopefully, to that line. Maybe. Doesn't want to work today. That's fine. And then I'm going to do a guided curve. So a swept boss. And the profile that I want is the circle because it's like a wire. And then I want it to follow this curve. Stop it. So that's how you can make a fun little shape. if you want something swept or something that follows a specific curve to make wires, sometimes you want to show wires in CAD, that's how you do it. I went through it kind of fast, but that's the basic idea. Does anyone have any questions on that? Well, that's all I have. Emilio, is there anything you want to show?
You want me to show off the width mate real quick?
Sure.
It'll take a second then. And then that's all I have on the top of my head too. I guess I could try to show off surfaces, though it's not something that's easy to teach in like one little session. So what I have now is a square hole and then a little square box that needs to fit right in the center of the hole. I've put one mate already just so that these are on the exact same plane. But I should be, it's basically can't move, it can only move around, can't move like in it. So to do a width mate, we'll go into the advanced mate section and hit width. You'll want the outside selections of basically the two things this is supposed to be centered in, and then you want the two edges of this piece. So these two, and then clicking this face, it should slot right into the center like that. That's still only one, it's still got one dimension it can move in, so then I could just repeat the mate again. These faces, these ones to get it centered. And that's a width mate. I always forget how to do this one for some reason, so I have to look it up every time.
Yeah, and I guess just the last point on mates is that, especially if you select them ahead of time, or even if you just go in the mate, so you can, okay, let me organize my thoughts here. So the first thing is that you can select certain edges and faces and then mate them. So if you wanted to, and that's usually how I do it, is if you wanted to like make the two top faces coincident, you could just select the two, like you would select one and then hit control and select the second one. And then some mates, possible mates usually pop up. So Emilio does it differently than me, which is funny.
So I followed Katie's method, select both faces, then hit mate, and it's showing me it can do coincident, parallel, perpendicular, it can lock them, give me a distance, give me an angle, there's a lot of options. And then this is a great final place to show the flip mate. Say if I don't want it this way, I can just flip it around.
Yeah, so it'll show you in there, but then also I think you went a little bit too fast, but normally how I do it is I don't even hit mate. So if you go back and control select both of the faces, and then usually if you don't move, I don't know, maybe it's not doing it on your computer, but for me, if I just like wait a second, there you go. A bunch of possible mates will pop up. And that's how I do it. And even if it like doesn't pop up for some reason, if I move my mouse, like if you move your mouse, it won't pop up. I just like redo it until it pops up because I hate going into that mate like feature. I hate it. And then you can also right click on mates and flip them. You don't have to like open it up. So there's a bunch of shortcuts, but it as always, it comes down to your personal preference, how you like to do things. But those are just some different ways of seeing how to do it. Like Emilio said, it shows you the possible one. So it's not going to let you do something that you can't do if it like doesn't make sense with SolidWorks. Sometimes you feel like you should be able to do it. Like I've tried to make slots before, slot mates, and it won't let me. So sometimes it just comes down to like how you're selecting things, what you're selecting, and the order that you're doing it. So sometimes you might have to like try a couple times because it is SolidWorks, and SolidWorks is powerful, but it is irritating. And those are probably my closing words. I'm just waiting for the day that someone from SolidWorks watches these YouTube videos and gives us a call. But anyways.
It tells us how we're doing everything wrong.
Yeah. Although the SolidWorks professor at PCC actually like talks to the SolidWorks people and yells at them whenever he doesn't agree. And he will go on about that in class. So if anyone takes that class, because there's only one teacher at PCC, and he's great. And he will tell you everything wrong about SolidWorks. But yeah. So anyone have any final questions? No. Cool. Okay, I'll put this video on the PSAS YouTube, and I'll probably post it in the structure channel after it's on YouTube so that everyone has that link. And other than that, thanks for joining. I was worried no one would be on. So thank you, everyone. And yeah, that's all.
Happy SolidWorking.
Yeah, go make things. All right, bye.